Hi, hi, it's San, your national representative of love and fluffiness, and we're here with another season of Fuwa Call Time. Yay! So last season, in season 2 of Fuwa Call Time, we looked at a few clubs in Singapore who did Odottemita. And this year, we're back to doing Odottemita guests. Yes, so we're doing international Odorite this year. Odorite who are either iconic in the global scene or really contribute to their local Odorite community. Yes. So, our first guest for today is... Tuna!
Hello! Hi there, I'm Tuna. This is my 9th year as an Odorite. And I originally was dancing in America. But now I moved to Tokyo. I'm doing a lot of Odottemita here. Oh, it's been a year here
it's
in Tokyo.
It's quite recent. Mm. You're there for work.
Yeah, I moved for work, but honestly, Odottemita was always on the back of my mind. Just like, if I move to Tokyo, I can dance more.
Me and Tuna, we go far back. Yeah, quite far back. I think I first met you when we did a mega collab. Yeah, my first mega collab, which was Sunny Days. Mm. Yeah, so that was like 5 years ago. And then it's like, okay, remember me when you're famous. No. And we remember each other now, yes.
Yes, of course I remember you.
So, since you've come to Japan, you've been doing a lot of Odottemita again. I want to ask you, like, what was the dance community like when you were in America, and like, what's it like now that you're in Japan?
So when I was in America, I think, well, first, Odottemita is a very niche community. There's not a lot of people that are into it, so it was really hard to find friends that are also into Odottemita. But luckily, I had Juke, who actually lived about like not even 10 minutes away from me. Yeah, it was just a coincidence. She just happened to live really close. So I was able to still, you know, participate in Odottemita with friends that were in that in my area in America. But if I wanted to do bigger group covers when I was in America, it was really hard to gather people because everyone's come from all over America. And then the one choreography or the one video I actually got to do when I did Ihudodo, Pomp and Circumstance. Yeah, that was really hard to put together because it was all Odorite from California, but we had people coming from Northern California, but we came from Southern California. So we all kind of met. We didn't meet in the middle because we don't know what's going on in Middle California, but we met in somewhere in SoCal, Southern California. And yeah, I don't know how we made that happen, but it worked out. But I really wanted to collab with people from like the East Coast too.
California's in the East or the West?
California's on the West. Oh. And then New York, that area is on the East side. So, but yeah, no, the main difference between the two, like American Odottemita community and Japanese Odottemita community, is the distance where people like live. So it's a lot easier to people collab here in Japan. And yeah, all you had to do is really just go into their DMs and be like, I know you kind of live in Tokyo, or even Osaka is a little far, but it's like a 2-hour train ride. So it's so much easier to gather people to do videos, which has been so helpful because there's so many things I want to do. And then another difference I feel like is, which I didn't realize until I got here, is the community is much, much more competitive, or like, I didn't expect it to be so competitive. I do feel there is a little bit like a hierarchy in the community itself, where of course, like the people who are succeeding, who have a lot of followers, who have been, who make a lot of really good choreography, they're kind of like placed on the pedestal, and then everyone below is just like, oh, so cool. And then it's hard for us who's not in that same upper area as them to even ask them to do covers together.
Yeah.
We have to ask you, you know, we can't just be like, I know you are very famous, and but I want to collab with you. usually just gets ignored in the DMs, which is fine because I know my worth. Like, I will try my hardest, you know.
It's also probably a bit of like Japanese culture, you know, right? Where you're afraid to approach senpais.
Yeah. It's just, I guess it's just Japan. So, as long as you're having fun dancing with the people around you, like, isn't it fine? But because of like that competitive mindset that a lot of people have, people tend to get a little bit sad, like, oh, I want to get better. And honestly, full support. Like, if you want to improve, go for it. But I'm comfortable in my little zone with my friends. So I don't like to dive into that competitive part.
I think like, especially like on Nico Nico, they even have like the rankings, right?
Yeah, because they have the ranking, I feel like that's like another reason people get a little bit more competitive. Just like, oh, this video went ranked number one, so I was better than everyone else for this video, stuff like that. And then even the performing at Chokaigi, that the entry process was by videos. So you post a video, and then with the amount of my lists and amount of likes your video gets, that there's going to be a ranking for each category, like male soloist, female soloist, male-female duo, female group, stuff like that. And then the top three videos for each category get to go perform at Chokaigi.
In like one of the stage segments.
Yeah, so in one of the biggest Odottemita live stage, stuff like that. And so Nico Nico themselves kind of push for that competitiveness.
Oh, but like if you're a very big Odorite, then like you submit for Nico Kode, then you're probably gonna... Do they like restrict?
Yeah, they're not really too strict about who enters. So I know Meitoru-san, she entered... how many of her videos went through? But most of them went through. It was wild. She was in so many songs.
I was like, oh, Metoru, you just need to ask. You don't need to enter this competition.
We love Metoru-san. So I was like, you know, keep going. Like, submit more videos. It's going to be a solo concert of just her. We like that. But that Odottemita Live at Chokaigi actually also had a... you could also get in by luck. So I think four groups were by raffle. Out of all of the entries for all of the videos.
Raffle?
Yeah, it was like a raffle. So four people got the lucky chance to perform with these like people who won the ranking, which was really cool.
Crazy.
Yeah. So it was really awesome to see a lot of new faces. They're really good too. So I was like, maybe I'll ask them to collab with me one day.
You also got in through the Nico Kore competition.
Yeah, it was a group called Mannequin, or we did the song Mannequin by
the Mannequin choreo.
That one actually didn't get the top three for the female collab category, but we got into the top 10 of all videos uploaded for Odokore. So let's see, I forget what ranking we were, but we were one of the ones that barely made the cut, so we got a chance to perform. But it was kind of a group that was put together very like last minute, and not a lot of us live in the same area, so we couldn't practice as much. So the video of that event is still, you can still watch it on Nikonama in the Odottemita live stream for Chokaigi, but you could kind of tell we didn't have enough time to practice, which I'm really kind of sad about. I wish we had a little bit more time to prepare so we can make 100%, or we can put our all into the stage, but... Unfortunately.
How do you guys choreograph that one? Because there's so many people.
It was all choreographed by one of the girls, Sudachi-san, who was in the white. I think she's in the center at the beginning of the video. It was all her. She did the choreography. She made the formations.
Whoa.
It was really good. And then for that video specifically, we actually only had 2 days to prepare it. She gave us the choreography that week. And then we met on Saturday morning at like 8 a.m. practice for 2 hours, and then the next morning we practice for another 2 hours, and then film on that next day. So
wait, then you also got your costumes together in 1 week?
Yeah, the costumes, I mean, we had prepared beforehand.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but so prepared so last minute. So I was actually surprised when we finished the video, like the amount of time we put into this is pretty good.
So value.
Yeah, and it was with a lot of odorites I really like, so honestly really good
Wait, how long was filming for that?
Filming, I think we only had the studio for about 4 hours. But 1 hour was spent like setting up the studio to make it look fine, because there was a lot of like chairs and stuff. And then, yeah, we finished in about exactly 3 hours. But we also had to take photos, so the two outfits part was the hardest, because usually when I film any like solo, I take at least 3 hours to do by myself without changing. But we had a group, and we had to change in the middle. We're like, oh, are we gonna make it? But we finished right on time. So, but wait, there's one more thing I wanted to talk about for events. So I kind of said it earlier, but actually, events is the one thing I really wanted to talk about, because in the American Odottemita community, there's not a lot of events that are just for Odottemita. So in I think Germany, there's Dokomi, which is a big Japanese convention, and they have like the Odottemita section where a lot of like the Odorites even come, and a lot of the people around Europe actually go to celebrate Odottemita at like this one part of a mini convention. Same thing for in America, we had Anime Expo.
I've heard of that one.
Yeah, they had like the small, sometimes the J-pop dance workshop stuff that actually Juke used to do a lot.
And also competitions, right?
Yeah, there was competitions. I used to enter those. Wow, memories. But there's no events just for Odottemita. But here, every weekend, there's some kind of Odottemita event. It's crazy because maybe like famous Odorite would like gather through
Diamond Renta, like every month.
There's like she's going. I love her. And then my friend Wani too, she tends to go and do a lot of events. I feel like she's always like, wow, there's no weekend where I don't have an event. And I'm like, whoa. Because I'm the type that I personally don't get invited to a lot of events because I have zero fans. So if they invite me, they can't sell tickets because nobody will. But it's okay. I'm not doing this for profit. So I like to dance because I like to. So the format of how each event gets planned is actually cool too, because some person will be like, I want to do an event. I'm going to rent this live house and I'm going to invite Odorite and we're going to do an event. So he'll invite a few Odorite, and then we get all put into like maybe a Twitter group chat. Sorry, X group chat. And then
Japanese use Twitter. I mean, X.
Yes. And so we get put into this group chat. Once we see who's in the event, we are given about 2 slots of songs you can do. So each person, maybe if there's 10 people invited, each person gets 2 slots. So that means that you can do 2 songs. And then in those 2 slots, you can either use one to do your own solo, or you can use it to do a collab video. So usually a lot of people, what they do is they do 1 solo, and then they do 1 group 1 that they want to do. And then for the group one, they can invite whoever they want.
Outside of the original invited group?
It has to be out of the members of the invited group.
Okay.
So I was invited to an event by myself, and then maybe like Wani is in that list. So I use 1 of my slots for a solo video or a solo choreography. And then the 2nd slot, I'm like, I kind of want to do a collab with Wani. And I want to do Bloody Groovy. Okay, I DM Wani. Hey, Wani, I know we're going to be in this event together. Do you want to do Bloody Groovy with me at the event? And she'll be like, sure, yay. And then now my 2 slots are filled. So those are the 2 songs I can do at the event. But if another person who is also at the event want to use 1 of their slots to come to dance with me, then they can invite me and use me for their slot.
So everyone kind of has 2 song choices, and at the same time, they are dancing in at least 2 songs.
Yeah, so each person will at least get 2 songs. And then, but some events are different. Some people get, some events get 3 songs, depending on how many people are invited, the length of the event. And also, there's one event that does by time limit. So you get 12 minutes. You get a 12-minute slot and fill it up however you like. So for that event, a lot of people like to do like 1-minute songs, so they can do like, they can have more songs. The best part about these events is the the photos you can take with the Odorite. And then I brought a few. I actually was so ready that I prepared a few to show.
Yay!
So at a few events, like this is with Yuki-san, UK. He's in a group called Fudanjo. Like this is with Toxic, which is another Odorite group that I recommend a lot. It's a they're all female, they're all girls, but they like to dress up, stuff like that. The Czechie culture as well. These are all my collections. Yay! Then you can also buy like random Czechie, which I have a few examples of oney. Where it's just like autographed little cute Czechies you can buy of these people. So a lot of the Odorite, if you perform at an event, a few places, there's gonna be like a thank you for performing, here's like your payment because you performed for us.
Oh
But
yeah, performance fee.
you only get the performance fee if you were able to bring in a fan. So when a fan buys a ticket, they write down, oh, I'm going to this event for this person. And then with whoever's name they put down, then that person gets a profit from the ticket they sold. Versus a few events, you don't get any profit at all. But at the end of each event, then they have the little checky time where you can take photos and talk to your oshi, stuff like that. So that's all, how a lot of people, how a lot of the Odorite get, I guess, money back for what they put in. Because Odottemita, nobody really can do it for profit unless you're in that like hierarchy zone, because then you're getting money back from like a lot of fans you have. But people like me who's kind of doing it more for fun, man, so much money going down the drain. Not down the
Mostly
drain,
costumes, right? Mostly costumes.
costumes too. But in Japan it's a lot more common to pay to have a studio, pay to have a film. And then I live in like a high-rise apartment, so it's hard to practice at my house, so I have to also rent a studio to practice.
Just to practice, huh?
So the amount of money that goes into one single video would be like, if I'm lucky, it's gonna be like 50,000 yen, so like $500. It's yeah,
Wait,
because the
huh?
it depends on who films you. But a lot of the
Oh.
really good people, like Gito, for example, he is at least 25,000, like
I
about
see.
250 USD.
He has like his rates on his Twitter or something.
Yeah, and then because his filming is amazing, like he's literally moving so much. Versus a video, like a still video, would be like maybe like 8,000 yen, so it's not that much. So if you're in one still video, it's really
He'll be
affordable.
like,
But
I'll come down with my tripod. You know,
yeah,
I could even just set up my iPhone.
I know. So when I filmed in America, I used to use my phone. Like Bloody Groovy was filmed on my iPhone. But now I have experienced the quality filming of all the yeah. So I can't not ask them anymore, because it just looks so good.
And
Expensive.
they also like set up all the lighting and everything for you,
Yeah,
right,
but
in the
you just look
studio.
good. You look better with all the lighting and just quality. Like if I want to put out a video, I want it to be, the best that I can do, because then I'll be happy. So a lot of the videos I end up doing is
Oh, expensive hobby.
but by going to the events, and then I mean, if I had fans who are actually buying Czechies, I don't have a lot of fans, but if I had people coming to like my Czechie session, then it's a lot easier to kind of make money back for what you're putting in. So that's what a lot of people do. But still, I don't make enough to cover what I lose in this hobby. So honestly, I'm doing this out of pure love. I love dancing. I love making videos.
Passion.
And so even if I'm not anyone, it's like
Okay, so now we're gonna go into some questions that some of the viewers sent in. The first one is not a question, it's from Cheryl MM Dancers, and she
I love
says, "Please eat proper meals, Tuna." So what's that about, huh?
So, whenever Shira comes to Japan, I think twice we met up and had dinner. But every time I'm always talking about how I don't eat properly because I'm so busy. So she always gets mad. But I'm trying, I'm trying.
You're
Recently,
living the
I have,
hustle life.
yeah, the hustle life. But I don't eat very healthy because there's a McDonald's near where I live. So if I get hungry, I'm like, French fries.
Is it
So
true Japan
I do.
McDonald's is better than other McDonald's?
Yeah, they have the one around me is not that good, so I don't go that much. But there's a Lotteria. The Lotteria is good. I even had it today. Today was my Lotteria day. But I'm eating properly now, so don't you worry. I will try to eat healthy. I will have a salad tomorrow to make up for it. Thank you.
Okay, the next section is about choreographing. So I think you have quite a few like choreographies that I would say are quite well known. I think, right, as long as like two people covers my choreographies, I'll be like, this is a success, you know? Like people are actually learning the thing I made.
If I see one video, I'm like, this is what I have succeeded. Thank you so much. You looked at me at like very slow speed. You saw me. I am so sorry I look like this when I'm slowed down, but thank you for learning my choreography.
It's like, oh, you even copied the part that I messed up. Oh my gosh. You thought that was intentional.
Like, I didn't mean to do that, but because I did in the video, thank you for learning it.
Yeah. So I think here in Singapore, at least here in Singapore, like I think there's quite a few people who really like your choreo. And yeah, some of my friends have questions like, what are your inspirations for choreographing? In particular, like someone asked, how do you put together the complex story of heterostasis inside the choreography? So can you tell us about like your choreography process, especially like the creative side of it?
So when I want to make, or I will first find a song that I want to do for choreographing. So I love music, so I listen to a lot of music. And then as I'm listening, if I find one where I'm like, wait, I can kind of dance to this, then I'll put it into like a playlist. And then I'll listen to it so many times to a point where I've memorized kind of where the beats are, where like, ooh, this sound would sound really cool if I kind of make this move. This kind of sound sounds like it would look like this. So a lot of the choreography is actually done when I'm listening to music, pretend like on my way to work or something. I just have headphones and I'm listening to the music. They're just like, oh yeah, this would be really cool. It looks like this. So until I actually get to start moving, I do a lot of like image training. So if I have a song that is very like kind of sexy, kind of like cute, femme, I will go and get a lot of inspiration by what's a video that I really like that kind of has the same vibe. So in order to get like the same like inspiration, I'll just watch a whole bunch of videos that have the same vibe and just like, oh yeah, I want to do something like this. I want to do something like this. And then I'll stand in front of a mirror like, all right, time to do
Time
it
to
on my own.
move.
That like moving around. That looks kind of good. Maybe not that, but oh yeah, that looks good. So a lot of it's just done. Yeah, most of my choreography is actually done like image training. And then if it's a choreography with a lot of people, then I do I write down like formations, like where people are gonna stand, like on a notebook, and then I'll be like, oh, this is where this person would stand, this is where this person would stand. And I'm trying to see if I have my notebook somewhere around here. Yeah, I do.
Oh.
So wait, my handwriting is atrocious, so I do apologize. But oops, this is a video that's not out yet, so let's not do that one yet. Oh, this is one of the ones I did with Runachi in Wani.
Oh.
Yeah, so I just write down, I just literally sit there, listen to the music. I'm like, all right, now what do I want this shape to look like? Right. Yeah, and then how do I want them to move? Ooh. So when it's group choreography that I make, then I have to do this kind of formation building before, like the first practice. So I just, no time is wasted. So that's another thing I do. I'm gonna go back and read the questions real quick because I think I'm going off topic.
Oh,
Give me
no
one.
way. Actually, you mentioned earlier that you have like inspiration on like the train while you're in public transit. If that
Yeah.
happens, then how do you keep track of like your ideas, right? Do you just like
I
quickly
just
make a memo?
honestly, that's what I should do because sometimes I think of great ideas. I'm like, this will be so good. And then I get home, I'm like, dang, I don't remember. I'm sad. So
Sad.
yeah, you're right. Maybe I should start taking notes. But then, man. Yeah, a lot of the inspirations come from different genres of dance. So recently I really like the feminine. I love whacking, I love voguing. I'm not very good at it because I haven't learned it professionally, but I do like to watch a lot of like drag queen videos, them doing like the voguing stuff. So one day I want to be able to do a very Vogue-based dance cover. I had one planned once, but I stopped because I was like, man, I can't Vogue yet. So
Oh, not
like
ready.
2 years. Yeah, 2 3 years I'll be a the best voguer in town. No. But if I'm ever able to do that, that would be fun. But the other question that you mentioned, it was the
Oh, yeah,
heterostasis. Yeah.
heterostasis.
So I love Crow Noir. That's just one of my Oshi groups. So whenever they release a song, I'm like, this is so danceable. I want to do it. And then so usually when I upload a Crow Noir video, it's always for like to celebrate something they've done. So Bloody Groovy was like right after their first solo 3D concert, and then Heterostasis was when they released the album that Heterostasis is in. So, the song was released on YouTube beforehand, so I just was always listening to it. And then as I was listening to it, I'm like, this is danceable. So I was watching the MV and I'm like, the story is so, this is so sad. I wanna do the sad dancing. Into the choreography itself, I feel like I didn't blend it in as much until it got to editing. When I was editing the video, I put in quotes from the actual video for Heterostasis, had a lot of quotes, which kind of build into the Crow Noir plot. So when editing, so I actually edited that video myself. And then so I'm slowly sitting there trying to figure out, all right, so when does this text come in? When would be the good time to bring this text in? Right here. And so slowly I built the video afterward. But so another one of the inspirations when I make the choreography is actually the original video of, or the music video of the song. So like for Heterostasis, there's a lot of scenes where Kuzuha and Kanae are holding hands. So at the beginning of the choreography, is it the beginning? It should be the beginning. me and my Blanche partner, Jenny, we were just holding hands. So I like to mimic a lot of the shapes that the people are making in the video. So even for Yoidore Shirazu, the girl is like holding a cigarette, or I don't know what
Yeah.
it is, like this. So I was like, what if I put that in the choreography? Oh, there it is.
Oh.
Like that, yeah. Oh, yeah, that's where I can put it in. So the hand holding for Heterostasis was that. I don't remember, but a lot of the shapes I make in the videos do come from the MV itself.
Okay, so earlier on you mentioned that for a lot of the videographers in Japan, like their paid videographers. So, do they also handle the planning of like the videos and the editing as well? Like, how does the shots show up?
So editing, yes. So filming and editing is all done by the person you pay, because it is kind of, you are paying them to do the service. So it is their job to finish the video until its editing process. But the cuts of the video and the camera angles you want, it really depends on the person. So for me, when I want to do a video, before I get to filming, I list out all the cuts I want. So first cut, close up of me. Second cut, it's going to be a far shot of me, and it's going to be still camera. This next shot is going to be kind of far, but it's going to be moving, stuff like that. So if I have an idea of what I want to do, then I'll come with a list prepared. But if it's some people would just show up with nothing, and then they'll ask the filmer, hey, so what do you think would look good? If so, they'll basically, the filmer that then becomes the director of the video and kind of is like, oh, maybe you can cut it here and I'll film you from this side. But I think for a lot of my videos, I have a like my own vision of how I want it to look like.
So
So
you
I'm
plan it
always like,
yourself.
oh, yeah, so I'm like, I'm gonna like go down here. So can you like follow me? And they'll be like, yes.
Yes.
Yes, I will go down with you. So a lot of the filmers, at least the big three, not the big three, but the
Big big
affordable
three.
three.
Johnny Sama, Johnny Sama, Gito.
Johnny-san is not in the affordable three because he's so,
Oh.
he's like up here. He's really expensive, like 2 or 3 times the price of
Oh.
the affordable three. who are Gito, Ito, and Ichi-san. So those are like the big three that a lot of people go to ask to get filmed. But recently there's a lot of, not younger, but fresher filmers. Like Raimu-kun is one of them, and Oshio-san is another one that a lot of people tend to ask. They're more affordable than even like the affordable three. So the affordable three I'd go to for like, if I want a like really high quality video, like they know they do this professionally. This is their main job. Their job is to film, versus like other people, it's their hobby. So although they're a little bit more inexpensive, you can kind of tell their experience level isn't as high up. But honestly, even those people are improving lately. So my video that I did with Michiru the other day was filmed by Oshio-san. And then I haven't received the video yet, but looking at the video on the camera, it looked really good. Like, she's getting really, really good at filming. I'm really excited to get the video back and to post it.
Okay, yeah, so when you plan your own video shots and like the close-ups, white panning, like is there a logic to it, or are you just like logic? How do you experiment? Like, how do you know what will look good?
Honestly, a lot of times I'm just like, tell the videographer, just like, so this part I kind of want to see my whole body, so kind of just keep it in the middle to far range, don't come too close to me because I want to be able to see every part of my body. And they'll be like, okay. And then they'll start moving on their own and see what looks good.
Oh.
And we'll look at the video together. And he's just like, oh, maybe I should have done it like this. Can we try again? We'll try again. And then we look at it again. Oh, that looks good. Let's do it like that. And then if that was like a practice take, then we'll do the actual take, stuff like that.
And this happens like on the same day, like on the day of
filming. Yeah, as we're filming. So like, let's film this first scene. Do a test shot of the first scene. All right, that looks good. So let's actually film it now. And then we actually film it. And then, all right, next scene.
That's why you take 3 hours for a solo video.
Yeah, 3 hours. If it's just one straight shot video, no cuts, then it would probably take like 20 minutes.
Yeah.
I filmed one of my videos, when I filmed Nightmare, that was a still shot one video. That was maybe the third take.
And then you're so like, okay, pack up. Like,
yeah, I finished in maybe 20 to 30 minutes. So that was super fast.
Okay, another question we have is that you sometimes cosplay or like dress up like similar to the MV characters in your videos. So like, do you have practical advice for makeup and costumes when you're dancing?
Oh, makeup and costumes in general.
Yeah.
Does it have to be like about cosplay or just like,
I guess anything, right? Like, It's the same, right? I don't cosplay. It's the same, okay. Right? Just wearing a nice clothing.
Yeah, wearing a wig is like the, maybe the main difference, but if it, I have an advice for when dancing in cosplay, it's going to be always glue the wig to your face, because otherwise 100% is going to fly off. So a lot of pieces like this kind of piece, if I was cosplaying, I would just glue it to my face so it doesn't move. But
do you do the hairspray thing? Like the bangs, yeah, hairspray thing? Hairspray. Yeah. Game changer.
Yeah. And then another thing for if dancing in cosplay, because the costume kind of is already decided for you if you're going to do the cosplay, because like maybe if a character is wearing that outfit, then you have to wear the outfit. So you kind of have to find a dance that suits the outfit, or maybe if it restricts your movements, you have to figure out how to kind of overcome that. So one of my songs that I did in cosplay, it's a video I did maybe last year or 2 years ago, Taylor. So when I'm wearing that costume, I can't raise both my arms up at the same time, because right here is so tight. So if you watch that video really carefully, I'm never raising both my arms up at the same time, and all of the choreography is done here, because I can't raise my arms. So if I raise one arm, like it would maybe go up to like here. If I did raise both arms, it'd be like here. But it would never go both up. So it's kind of funny. If you watch it knowing that, like, it kind of changes. Oh, I did make that.
That's why it looks like that.
Yeah. So when I made that choreography, I was like, I know I can't raise my arms, so I have to do all the choreography here. All right, let's keep it here. So knowing your limits in the outfit is also good. So always practice in the outfit before you film, because you never know. You
Full
get to
dress
the film.
Rehearsal.
I can't raise my arms. What to do, like that would be really bad. So but Another advice I have actually for finding outfits for any cover, don't go out and buy a new outfit if you don't have to, because if you do that, you're gonna be poor like me. So, but recently a lot of my video is done with costumes that I already had at home, or I have a lot of, I like fashion, so I have a lot of clothes at home. So I just put together everything I have, and it's like maybe this will look good for this cover, maybe this will look good for this cover. So, the last time I actually bought a new outfit for a cover, a whole outfit for a cover, was maybe Rabbit Hole was the last one I bought an entire outfit for the cover. And then other things, maybe some parts are new, like I bought some few parts, but other parts might be reused. So, another, if you look at my past videos, you'll always see the same black skirt. Because that's like the one thing that just
That's a
looks good with everything.
staple.
So yeah, it's a staple, like a black pleated skirt. You can match that with anything. So wearing that one in Bloody Groovy, I'm wearing that one in Game Over. I'm wearing that one in, oh man, Zombie. I'm also wearing that in Zombie. Seriously, if you go back and look at the video, if you see a black pleated skirt, that's the exact same one. She's actually been in like 10, 15 videos probably. So keep an eye out for that. So
Yeah, check it
don't
out
feel,
in
yeah, check them out.
the
Don't feel
next
stressed to buy, like, spend money for a new outfit. If you have something that just works at home, just it will save your wallet
video.
and you can eat better food with the
Yes.
money you saved.
I also try to like just whatever I existing have. Maybe when I was younger, I thought like, yeah, I want to get clothes because I guess legit, I didn't have clothes. So getting clothes for dance covers was a good way. But then now I'm like, if I have it, I don't need to get more stuff. Yeah. Except for sometimes it's difficult when you have to match with other people,
Yeah,
like in
when matching with
groups.
other people, then we
Yeah.
try to buy a new outfit.
They're
Or
like,
at least like
oh, does
we talk
everyone
about it.
have a blue and white outfit? And I'm like,
No. I
that's not my
only own black.
color.
Black is the only color in my closet. Cannot
Mm.
do. I used to be really obsessed with buying a lot of dresses from this Japanese Lolita, I guess, brand called Amavel. So I have a
Oh,
closet. Yeah, I have
yes.
a whole closet filled with Amavel dresses. Oh,
Do I
you
have
got
it?
one? Yeah,
Is it here?
got
Is it here?
that one.
Oh, my Mabel dress isn't here, but I got like, yeah, this is a Mabel top and like a Mabel skirt.
So
It's
cute for sake.
honestly, it's just cause of Benda. Like I saw her blog say like, oh yeah, I like a Mabel. And I was like, I like a Mabel.
And then it's more of the affordable Lolita brand. So when I was really obsessed with that brand, every time they had a new release, I'm like, oh, buy. Oh, this one's cute, buy. And then so I have like maybe like 30 dresses from Amabelle that I have not worn for covers yet. So
Oh
yeah.
shit.
I think about like I'm gonna use this for videos. I'm gonna buy it. No, I was literally like fashion, buy. So
How much wardrobe space do you have?
none. So I had to buy a separate wardrobe to put all my Amabelle dresses in.
Actually, have you seen like me, you know Nanakawa Miko? Like I
I
saw
got
like
you.
a video or something, then like she opens and it's like one room full of clothes, all her costumes and stuff. Like just multiple rows and then hangers of all her outfits. It's insane. It's insane. Yeah, okay. I
See,
don't have that kind of space.
not too much like that, but maybe one day if I have a big house, that will be my dream to have a, this is my costume closet. You can borrow anything from here. So, oh yeah, that's another thing. If you have friends that you can borrow clothes from, do it.
Yes,
Always borrow.
do
Don't spend
it.
money.
Yeah, I wanted to ask, moving forward, do you have any like goals that you want to achieve or like any like live events or videos that you're working on right now that you want to share?
For goals, honestly, just to have fun, just keep doing, no matter how busy I am, I will always make time for Odottemita. So yeah, let's just enjoy the Odottemita life, have fun. But for live events, I actually have one. Most of it's not been announced yet, so I can't talk about it too much, but there is one that's on June 30th. I'm gonna be me and Wani are, we're actually invited together to participate. We haven't decided what song to do yet for that, probably, but we're gonna make an original choreography together. And then speaking of original choreography to do at events, so me and Wani actually made a lot of original choreography to do at events that's never been filmed. Some of the songs being
You're
like,
saving it for live events.
more like we just haven't had time to film. It's kind of sad. I really want to film it. So we actually did, do you know Mori Calliope and Kira? They have a song called Q, which is written by Deco27. And I really like that song. So we actually have a choreography for that together. We also did a song called Kiss Me Shot by Nykist, which is another Vocaloid song. And then recently me, Dunachi, and Wani did a original choreography for one of songs by Utsupi, which is actually one of my favorite Vocaloid producers. So eventually we want to do videos for those, but right now it's only
Backlog.
for live events. Maybe I'll tweet about it one day because we do have videos of the live event. And I think we're allowed to tweet those, so I keep saying tweet, post those, but
Yeah, if there's nothing else, thanks for being here, Tuna. Yes.
thank you for
Woo.
inviting. I love to talk, as you can probably tell, so I was really excited to join this call.
Yes. If I go to Japan, I would totally come and hunt you down to talk more.
When you come to Japan, please, this is a message out to all my international Odorite. If you're ever gonna be in Tokyo, send me a DM. Like, if it's not a crazy busy week, I will make time for dinner. Let's just like go grab a meal or something. Let's talk about life, you know? I don't bite, though.
Hey, do you have any social media, your Nico Nico, your YouTube that you want to plug out there? Now is your time.
Yes, so my Twitter or X is I think Tuna underscore killer with two L's and two E's, and then my Instagram is I think
I'm
I'm
a
a
little
little Tuna,
tuna.
yes, and then I do have a Nico Nico my list and stuff like that, but because I can't remember off the top of my head, I
It'll
guess
be in the
if you can
description.
put it in the description below, that would be great.
Hey. And with that, we're end of the first episode. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, Tuna, for being here. And
Listen.
we'll see you at the next episode. Next episode, the guest is Ellie
Who's it?
Hina from Germany. Yes. So stay tuned. It will upload eventually. Jane.